Find the area of R, so that one, let's go to this page. So, I like to use F and G, but I don't really have a calculator, so it doesn't matter quite so much this time. So, let's see. So the area is going to equal, start at 0, go to x equal 2. The topmost function is linear, so that's got to be the 2x. The bottom function is the x squared. Now I need to find that integral, so these two are just being added. So I find the antiderivative separately. Don't forget the equal sign. So this becomes 2x squared over 2. Subtract x cubed over 3. And that needs to be evaluated between 0 and 2. Do we have any questions so far? Please.
So I just kind of have a hard time seeing it. So if that's the base of the solid, how does it
lengthen? So I kind of think what you're doing is you're remembering a problem and solving your memory, not this problem.
Okay.
No worries. Because this one didn't say anything about the base of a solid yet.
Right.
Okay. Just says find the area. So do you want to keep going or you? Okay, just making sure. Keep helping us. Anybody else? So plug it in. These you can reduce. So this would be 2 squared. Subtract 2 cubed over 3. When you put a subtraction sign, remember to put the big parenthesis. And we do it again. But if you put in 0, you're just going to get 0. So I have to take my eraser and say, I don't need that anymore. And I would stop right there. Except I need an equal sign. That would give me the answer credit, even though I didn't go all the way to the fraction. I have the antiderivative, that's right here. And I have the correct integrand, which is right here.
And I just know that you know it's -0.
Oh, in this case, it really wasn't -0, because it was the top function. So if the rectangles fit here, so you're actually subtracting the y at the top, which is found using the 2x, and then the y at the bottom is the x squared. So in this case, I don't have 0 at all. So it's just always the y coordinate at the top, subtract the y at the bottom. Two for Kennedy. Please, Sterling.
So I integrated the two equations first, and then I put in the values. Is that not always going to work?
So like you integrated 2x,
mm-hmm.
like you found the antiderivative.
Yeah, so I got x squared minus x cubed divided by 3.
Yeah, that's the same thing. X squared minus x cubed divided by 3, then it plugged in. So either way. Super Sterling, anybody else? Next one. Oh, sorry, Ben, please. Oh, so, yeah, sorry. So the way the points work for the game is if you got all three on your, well, whatever you get. So the points are here. Pebbles, you get double if you do it by yourself. And otherwise, if you did it with help or notes, help somebody else helping or notes, you just get what's listed. If you didn't get it, then you don't get it. So, cool. Next one. Okay, it says, now it's what Maggie was talking about. This is the base of a solid. But they, as always, you don't want to solve problems based on a previous problem, per se. You want to solve what's in front of you. So it says the region R is the base of a solid. For this solid, at each x, so like at this x, and this x, and this x, and all other x's in between, at every x, the cross section perpendicular to the x-axis. So I've drawn cross sections that are perpendicular to the x-axis. It's equivalent to this image we looked at in class, where here's the region. In fact, this looks very much like this problem. Here's the region. This software is dead. I have to restart it. So that's the region, and I tip my paper so that I can see the paper being, don't spin, the paper being flat, and then I put onto, I stack onto that region cross sections that are perpendicular to the x-axis. And so, and I make them square. Okay, the one we're talking about isn't square, but just for now. So that's the idea of a cross section that is perpendicular to the x-axis. Questions about that? The difference is they don't tell me that this, the cross sections are square. They tell me that the cross sections have this area. So what you do is you use your flashcard memory to say, okay, I know how to find volume. I always find volume by integrating cross-sectional area. If it were a square, I just find the area of a square. This one, they just tell me the area. Like, they tell me what the area of the cross-section is. It's this formula. So my volume is going to be, use this formula starting at x equals 0, go all the way to x equals 2, and for every x in between, plug the x into this formula to find the cross-sectional area of each individual slice. Multiply every slice or cross-section by the cross-section's thickness. That's what we need to do. Question. Anybody need me to say any of that again? Okay, so the big idea is, in fact, this picture helps me the most. If I'm trying to find the volume of a solid that looks like that, the way I do it is I don't look at the solid at all.
Look at each individual area.
Each individual cross-sectional area.
All right, so you're going to do it from 9, 8, 9, 8, 11.
Right, like what I'm really doing is I'm saying,
adding up all those areas.
Yes, I'm saying, hey, let's find that area.
All right.
Then let's move X over, so you can see it right here. It's a little small, but X equal
yeah,
point.
The area.
Does that make sense? Nicely done. So right here, that's what I did. This is how I find the area of one cross-section at one x. I multiply that by the thickness of the cross-section, and then I just repeat it for a million cross-sections.
Mm-hmm.
You good? Two for error. Please, sir.
So the equation above it, what is that?
So this is just my memory. You don't have to write that on the test. That's just me remembering that, oh, every time I find volume, the method I'm using is I'm going to integrate cross-sectional area.
Mm-hmm.
Two for Sterling. Anybody else? Please go.
Do they always give you the cross-section area?
It's actually quite unusual.
Okay, that's what I was wondering.
Yeah. No, it's a good example of like what we've been talking about, which is you can't really predict what they'll do, so you always go back to your flashcard concepts and just use the concepts.
Okay.
Yeah, you don't want to count on just, you know, having enough problems memorized, because they always find something new to do. That's a good question. Two couples. Anybody else? Sweet. So we have to do this, so let's see, antiderivative first. This is the sine of ax plus b rule. Susie Circle says antiderivative of sine is negative cosine. So this is 1 over a negative pi over 2 cosine of the ax plus b. Evaluated between 0 and 2. And, question? Please.
So you just put the negative with the 1 over a instead of the cosine?
Doesn't really matter. It's just, we've got to have a negative 1 somewhere. So they're just this times negative 1. So either way that I write it is fine.
Okay.
You wouldn't want to do this, though. Don't write it this way, Maggie. Two pebbles for Maggie. Because now it looks like you're subtracting.
If you did like a dot the next time?
Use parentheses.
Okay.
The dot can get lost. The grader might not see it.
Okay.
So this would be valid because they're multiplied. So either way. Anybody else? Two for Maggie? Cool. I was also going to point out this. Look. Another big key to the AP test, in my opinion, is don't do three things. Do one thing. And don't worry about what comes after step two until you've done step two. you just don't stress about the next step. If you get to a place where you can't figure out what to do next, it's easy, you just go to the next problem. Don't sit there, just move on. 66% is a five. So. This one's gonna become, this inverts, so that's negative 2/π. That's a multiplying constant. So I have the cosine of pi over 2 multiplied by 2 minus the cosine of pi over 2 multiplied by 0. And I would stop right there. Just make sure that you have all the right parentheses, because this is a big advantage to not having to work that out. But if you are missing a parenthesis, you're going to lose the point, because it won't be the right expressions. Question 2. So points were awarded. 1 point for the integrand. So that means you get a point here, or 2 pebbles if you did it on your own, for that. You can't forget the dx. It's a crucial part of it, because that's the thickness of your cross-section. Antiderivative means you found this. That's another point. Answer would be that. Questions? Good job.
Thank you.
Next one. Another solid has the same base R. For this solid, the cross section is perpendicular to the y-axis. Okay, so we've actually never done a problem in class where the cross sections are perpendicular to the y-axis. So I'm going to show you now. It's not common. This does not show up on the test very often, once in a while. Like, there are years where it doesn't show up at all. The idea is pretty simple, though, if you're comfortable with the other problem. Okay, you just have to change everything. So what you have to do is take this equation, y equals 2x, and you invert the equation. Invert means solve it for what, for x. So divide both sides by 2 and get x equals y divided by 2. Questions? You then invert the other equation. The process is pretty simple. So you've got y equals x squared. That means you just take the square root of both sides. So you get x is equal to the square root of y. Okay? Once you've inverted them, the cross sections now are squares, but they go like this. Okay, so you're still using a basic concept. That means the square is coming straight out like this. Questions on how it looks? So the area of a square hasn't changed. The area of a square is still L squared. This is L. But instead of top minus bottom, it's right minus left. So the function on the right is this one. So that means the area of the square is going to be the rightmost function, square root of y, subtract the leftmost function, and then that gets squared. Please.
So should we memorize that if it's perpendicular to the y-axis, then we should invert the equation? Mm-hmm. Do we need to know
why? I would say for this test, it's good enough to know the process.
Okay.
Like, if you're comfortable with the perpendicular to the x-axis, you just say, okay, I've just got to change everything to y. And so before everything was in terms of x, now everything is in terms of y. These formulas are in terms of x because they use x in the formula. Now we have formulas that are in terms of y because we use y in the formula. It's like instead of solving for the y, we're solving for the x. So yeah, I don't think you have to stress about the details of how it works for this test if you simply memorize the process.
Okay.
And then it's pretty slick. It's like, oh, no big deal. Just invert them, right minus left instead of top minus bottom. Otherwise, everything else is the same. No difference. Super Maggie, anybody else? Please,
what about all your
problems? So again, one habit you want to have is always reread. So I've done some work, I go back and read, make sure I answer the question. Another solid has the same base. for this solid, the cross sections are squares, right? But do not evaluate an integral expression. Oh, so I need to come up with an integral. So the volume's going to equal. Now this switches again, Maggie, to for Maddie's question. We don't go from x equal 0 to x equal 2 because the slices are going the other way. They're from y equals 0 to y equals 4.
So you don't have to specify on the integral that there's a y value?
The symbol at the end that says dy indicates that these are y values. Like, remember when we did u substitution and I talked about how once we write du, really we have to change the limits because they mean u equal. Two more from Maggie. So I take that one, square root of y, subtract y over 2, it all gets squared, and it's dy, because the thickness of the cross sections is the other direction. You have these squares like this, so their thickness is a change in y instead of a change in f. But otherwise, it's really the same idea. If you're doing it on a calculator, you can literally type into your calculator if you want y and y over 2. But on the calculator, you can just say, hey, the calculator doesn't know the difference. You type this in as root x and x over 2 and squared and dx, it doesn't know. So it works just fine. Good job, Rachel. Anybody else? Cool. So for those of you, again, the scores don't matter at all at this point. It's just a matter of getting a baseline and working to get better. There's a problem on the 2012 FRQ. So 8A students, we kind of just skipped this one. B-Day, we would talk about it, but we won't really talk about it, we'll probably skip it as well. But since we're on this subject, I'm going to show you how that one works. Just take an extra minute here. Again, because the score doesn't matter. What matters is that you work to get better. The problem with the 2012 looks like this. It's number 3. No, number 2. So it said, the horizontal line y equal k divides r into two regions of equal area. So we have a line. I'm probably a little high, so I'll erase that right here. It's probably more like about here. So that the area below is the same as the area above. And that's y equal k. Question. Write but do not solve an equation involving one or more integrals whose solution, you should have memorized on a flashcard, the solution to an equation is the value that makes the equation true. So we're looking for an equation that has k in the equation. The solution will be the value of k which makes the equation true. We need to talk about that again. Cool. Let's see. Whose solution gives the value of k? So I've got to somehow, so when I was doing this, I kind of thought this. I thought, well, if I start integrating like this, that would work, except that I don't know that point because I need to find that x coordinate. I don't know it because I only know the y coordinate. And I can't, like, use my calculator because I can't graph y equal k. So I had no way of finding this intersection. So when I got to that point, I thought for about another minute. After one more minute of thinking, my brain said, you're taking too long. And I went to the next problem. Okay. Just went and worked on something else. The solution is actually this. Integrate the other direction. Okay. Do rectangles that look like this. Okay, again, this doesn't happen very often. The process is what Maggie said, sorry, it's really simple. Invert the formulas. So you've got y equals ln of x. So to solve this, you use e, take both sides of the equation and exponent of e. you get e to the y is equal to x. So that inversion's done. And then we're going to talk about that. And invert the other one. The other one inverts really fast. It becomes x equals 5 minus y. And we need to talk about that. Cool. It's just like before, it was to find the area, it was top minus bottom. Now to find the area, it's right minus left. So the area is going to equal, we don't need an equal sign there. So I'm going to make an integral. And I'm going this way. So I start at y equals 0. I go to y equal k. I take the value of on the right, that's 5 minus y. Subtract on the left, that would be e to the y. That's going to compute that length.
This is like stupid.
No, it's not.
But when I did the 5 minus x, when I inverted it, I got y plus 5. Because I subtracted a 5 and then I divided it into 0.
Let's just write it down for a second. So you subtract the 5 from both sides.
Mm-hmm.
So what would the next line say?
Y minus 5 equals 0.
You're doing great. It's not a dumb question at all. It's a really good question because you're making a mistake. So we'll fix this so you won't make it again. It's no big deal. So you then what'd you do?
I divided the
over. So when you divide it over, you have to divide all of it. Like this. Like that. You can't do this. That's not legal because 5 isn't a factor.
Mm-hmm.
So instead, you have to say something like, well, if you leave it like that, that'd be fine. There'd be nothing wrong if you just put that in. Totally fine. Or you say dividing by negative 1 is the same as multiplying by negative 1. And then when you distribute, that's where you get negative y plus 5, which is the same as this. No, that's a good question. Two for Lauren. Anybody else? Sweet. That's it. Except this has to equal half of the area. And we found the area in the earlier problem to be 2.986. So that's how that one is solved. So it doesn't happen very often, but if you can memorize what Maggie talked about, just that inversion trick, it's really straightforward. That's why we don't really spend a lot of time in class doing it, because they don't test it very often, very rare. And when it happens, it only takes a minute to show you.
But you said you could use dx. If you were to plug that in your calculator, would you just put in dx?
Yeah, on your calculator, you just pretend that everything says y, but you're typing x.
So how does that work?
The calculator doesn't know the difference between x and y. All the calculator's doing is taking whatever this number is, plugging it into whatever this symbol is, so it doesn't care if it's an x or a y. Like when the calculator makes a graph, it cares. When it does the integral, it doesn't know it's a graph. It has no idea that you're using a graph or anything. It's just using a formula. So the formula really is just 5 minus blank. Call the blank whatever you want. E to the blank, E blank. I don't know if that helps.
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else? Please.
Do we have to get the area of the top half? So from k to 1?
You could. My solution was this, because that's an equation. It has an integral. And if I can find the value of k that makes that true, I've done what they want, because I just said that's half the area. The other way to do it, though, would have been this, Maggie. You could say, hey, let's go 0 to k, right minus left, so 5 minus y, subtract e to the y dy. And just say, hey, we want the two integrals to equal each other.
Oh, because areas have to be
the same. Areas have to be the same. So you'd say go from k, you'd have to find this coordinate here using your calculator.
Mm-hmm.
So that's got to be y equals something. I'll just say b, but you'd have to find the number. And then that would work. Same thing. Is that what you're thinking?
Or you could just say k to b equals 1/2 up to 2.986, right?
Yeah, this integral's got to equal that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I'm saying. I probably wouldn't write the integral.
Okay.
I just write that.
Okay.
Grayson.
So if this were a vertical line that the height didn't have, would it be okay to do, or would the way you solve it, would it be from 0 to k, would the integral from 0 to k, 5 minus x, and then the net equals the integral from 0 to k is some other thing? And then areas are equal, and that's what I mean.
If they had a vertical line, they'd probably have to be a little cautious about how they specify it, because the vertical line, if it's here, you could just do one integral from 0 to k of just ln of x. But if that line ended up being clear over here, you'd have to somehow account for both of those.
Please.
So on the last part, from
0
to
k,
would that be
like
the integral
from probably. Well, they could. If you had to find this antiderivative, everybody watch. To find this antiderivative, because you can't use the ax plus b rule, because this isn't ax plus b, and it's squared, so I can't just do them separately. You'd have to square it out first.
Okay, so
and then it gets, yeah, it'd be pretty nasty. Anyway, that's what you'd have to do.
Can you go back to the other one? How did you get to
so the problem said, write an integral. Write an integral. It said the horizontal line divides the two regions of equal area. So because I figured out in part A that the total area was this number.
Oh, so you just need the
right.
That
makes sense.
Yeah.
Perfect. That's actually why they do it pretty nice. Like, you remember that when they give you this, it's one problem with multiple parts.
Yeah.
So it's right in front of you. You can say, oh, wait a minute, we found that over there. So please, Meg,
super good.
So you're okay. It says the horizontal line y equal k divides r, here's r, into, again, strong advice, read really slow. Like, one way to get a lot better is read a lot slower. So the horizontal line divides R into two regions of equal area. So right there, they told me that this shaded area right here, I know the value. It's half of what I found in part A. Does that make sense? It says, right, but do not solve an equation involving one or more integrals whose solution gives the value of k. So what I did is I said, well, if I could find this area using k, which I did, that area would have to equal that. So whatever k is, the solution is that value of k. Here's a weird question. I have a mega double if you can answer this. Everybody can get it. Everybody. It's a good one. It's a really good, like, do you understand the concept question? So I said that the solution to an equation is the value that makes the equation true. So I'm saying, well, if I could find the right k, like, you can look up here, you know, this is 0, this is 1, so that's about 1.2 or something. So k is probably about, I don't know, 0.4, something like that. Why don't I have to worry about finding this value or this value to make the equation true? Okay, everybody knows. Megaphone. Why don't I have to worry about the y's? They look like, I'm kind of, you know, I understand I'm being a little sarcastic here, right? They look like variables. Why don't I have to find those values? Why does this equation only require that I find the value of k? I don't have to find those. They're not part of it. What's the y of that concept? It's a good question. Let's go, Sarah.
Because you plug in every value until you get
k. Nice. These are known, essentially. They're just 0, 0.01, 0.02, 0.03, 0.04, all the way to whatever k is. So the only thing that's really unknown is k. Everything else is known in this equation. That's awesome. How do you do that? That will occur.
So k is like a set value, but then y isn't.
Yes, perfect. How many got it? Ken?
Sorry, wild pitch. Well, you ready?
Oh. Nice. Ready? Sweet.